seconds remaining. Reserve time.
Sand King. So this is going to be Pablo Sand King. Oh, actually, no. What am I talking about? This is going to be the Kun Sand King and Pablo Slaughter, probably. So, maybe a dual offlane with the Slaughter. I would imagine that the Kun is probably going to be asking for a little bit of help in that offlane to set up for that aggression, especially Dire considering team. No Logic Gaming support duo. I mean, CM Weaver with a Sven in the lane, like, no matter which of the two is the core, that is a kill lane against that Sankey. He's going to have a lot of trouble laying in against that with the Root, with stuns, with the Beatles being annoying. So, we'll see what they do to fix that issue. Horde in the meantime.
5 seconds remaining.
I would imagine they want a mid laner who... TA? Yeah, I was kind of thinking about Radiant TA, but went away from it again, because like, you pick TA into a lot of armor. I guess the Corrosive Haze does take a lot of the armor away, so even in the small situations where Warcry is active, the Corrosive Haze will at least, what's it called, mitigate remaining. The Warcry completely, as maxed out Corrosive Haze takes 20 armor away, maxed out Warcry gives 20 armor, so they just deny each other, so the Temple Assassin is still useful as a hero on its own. And Excalibur, he had an amazing game on the TA last time, so why not give him another chance at it? Urza gets banned out by No Logic Gaming. Not wanting to give a very aggressive liner to the side of Horde, and Horde in the meantime. The last hero from the side of No Logic Gaming is going to be the offlaner, so... Batrider, maybe this could be a Batrider game because of the burn reserve against time. The Templar Assassin. Otherwise, probably something like a Centaur is going to be the most annoying hero left in the pool. Legion is another option. Nikwa did play Legion last time as well. Alright, they'll ban out the Jakiro. I like that. I like that a lot. This is Radiant just Horde saying, we know exactly what you played in the last couple of days to No Logic Gaming as... Last time I saw the Jakiro, it was a Jakiro offlane with played by Nikwa, and they dual laned it. I can't remember exactly what hero the second one was, but you know, a support hero plus the Jakiro in the offlane, and they did so much work in that lane. They destroyed a lifestealer, he got a lot of farm, and like I said, you kind of want to have a hero that can burn through the refraction charges off the Templar. Plus, Morphling just got picked up by Horde, so you want someone who can potentially try and pressure the Morphling in the lane. And the Jakiro would have been a perfect pick for both cases. Without having that available though, No Logic Gaming, Morphling. I guess you could always go back for something like, okay, yeah, Batrider gets picked up, so... I like that. Pretty good against Morphling, in terms of like early game pressure, if you can just get a limited amount of help. Good initiation hero, obviously. You have a lot of magical damage, you burn through the TA very easily. It's almost impossible for the Templar Assassin to get in and out of fights anymore against the Batrider, because normally what happens with the TA is like, well, when you have BK, well, you get BKB, and then it's like you can always blink in, blink out. But the second the BKB ends, you can't really disengage that much anymore, because Batrider does not allow heroes to walk away from a fight. That's just not what happens. That is just not what happens. Remaining. He will slow them, he will to the end of the earth, and he will kill them. Remaining. So let's see No Logic Gaming's lineup this game. It looks a lot more smooth, but bad reason why people have stopped picking him in the offlane. That is very easy to punish in lane. We'll see if they can make that happen. They don't have any good heroes against a Batrider, as per se, I suppose. I mean, they can like try and run him down, stun him like Rubik Lift into Slaughter, stun into the Morphling's waveform, but they don't really have a good kill lane against the Batrider. Should be a decent lane for him. Usually you're playing in something like Weaver Lifesteal every single game, but this is one of the small games where the Batrider is not a thing. Alright, they're memeing each other, boys. Why not? They're having a good time. confidential information. Alright guys, let's see. Akis on the move, on his rubric, trying to get some early vision down. He does have both wards on him, so they know this. They saw it with that CM, so it's not going to be too easy for them to hide where they have vision. I mean, having two wards on your rubric means that, well, they can guess that there's going to be a lane ward, and they can guess that the second ward can only be placed like around mid or something along those lines.
30 seconds to battle.
Let's see, Sven. Alright, looks like they want to go aggressive in the top lane as the CM is up here. The Shadow Fiend is securing things. The Sven is actually trying to dodge out this bottom lane. They don't want to play up against the Sand King by the looks. But is this just an attempt to get a first blood? Looks like that's just the first blood kill. They have both support heroes in lane. They want to get an early kill. Pavlo, he's going to be scouting out things. He may actually run into J4 if he's lucky. Oh, this is some tension right here. This is like the most tense situation. Oh, like how is this happening? How did that actually happen? J4 is actually legit standing still, just sitting there. Pablo's doing the same thing, and they haven't seen each other. They have not spotted out each other. Now they will. Oh, they will run into each other. They will see it. J4 is like pinging. He's like, Pablo's here. Pablo's here. Let's see. In the meantime, Nikwa is going to be run down. J4 does move in, tries to help him a little bit. The CM is not here anymore, though, so it's only going to be Pablo. He goes first on Nikwa. Is going to get a little bit of help, but he gets lifted the other way. He's going to be in trouble. He does have this healing cell. We'll go for the healing cell. We'll try and dodge around the vision. He knows he has to get the maximum amount of that healing cell. In the meantime, J4 is just bashing that morphling in the face. So they do get a lot of damage on both Pablo as well as Gork C, and they don't die. They don't lose any creeps or anything like that. So I guess J4's little move that did help out the Batrider to begin with. And let's see in the meantime. Kate's on the mid lane. He's sitting on 4-5 last hit, so he does have his souls to be able to contest Excalibur. It looks like he's having a much better game this time around. Bottom lane, the CM is in position to try and contest the Kun on that Sand King. He is level 2. He hasn't skilled up his Caustic just yet. Yeah, he skills it up now. So he's going to continue pressuring the Weaver. The Weaver has already taken a lot of damage. The CM is trying to get a little bit of farm for himself. He wants to get that little last hit. But the Sand King will probably just go and leech a little bit from it. Yeah, there's no point not leeching, as he will take half of that experience. Very, very nice way towards level 3 now. And let's see this dual lane top. I mean, they're still both level 1. They need to get levels on that Batrider. He does have last hits going his way. 5 last hits, 2 denies. So it's not like it's the worst farming in the world, but Batrider's a hero that if you want to get kills in the lane, you need levels badly. So we'll see if they can make that happen. The camp has been pulled. The Slaughter's on the move. He wants to take that bounty rune, and he will be successful doing that. So Pablo takes a little bit of gold for himself. In the bottom lane, in the meantime, just hiding himself in the trees. Hitting people a couple of times. He does have the skill point saved for now, as he doesn't want to use it in case of emergency. He can skill up his sandstorm if necessary. So let's see. He keeps on farming. He does have his bar strike skilled up now, so he does not want to skill up anything too well. Okay, Weaver gets hit. Takes a lot of damage here. You need to be careful though. As the Sand King does not have enough mana for another bar strike focus, that will take a lot of damage from the Sand King though. All in all, very nice laning from the Sand King. He's almost level 4, and the CM is just completely not being in this lane. So the Sand King should get free farm. Should get free farm. The CM in the meantime, level 2 in the jungle. Trying to work towards his level 3, stacking up a little bit to make sure that no value is lost in the jungle. Bottle gets completed by the Shadow Fiend. Him and the TA is both on even amounts of last hits. So the Shadow Fiend is having a good time in the mid lane. Top lane. Nikwa, he's being chased like a wild animal, and he's going to use his Firefly. He will be alive for the moment, And he's just going to go deep, deep into the trees. He can TP to the shrine, and then everything's going to be fine. That was a rhyme, by the way, guys. In the meantime, Smoke comes out in the mid lane. They want to go on Excalibur. They have the triple raise available. Kaiser, he gets two raises off. Oh, he had to use... Ooh, he may actually drop down here. One more hit from the Coon, but now the Root comes out, and Kaiser will be fine. He goes for Root. Oh, he turns around. He goes for Raze. He tries to pop the Coon, but the Root is only level 1. It does not last for that long a time. J4 didn't have a stun available at the moment. He didn't have enough mana to use it, so the Shadow Fiend will be the first blood to the Coon, and the Coon survives. How the hell does he manage to survive as well? Everything going right for the Sand King. He's active instantly, and he sets up for a nice turnaround kill. Alright, the Coon is first game. He had a good game on the Beast Master. He was more farm than his safe lane carry the whole game, and he's definitely setting his mark on the second game already. Level 5. Having a good start. The Bad Run in the meantime in top lane is getting good farm. He's sitting on almost 20 last hits, and he is nearing his own level 5 as well. J4 on the Sven. I mean, he's picked up a couple of boundary runes here and there, but he's level 2, maybe almost level 3. Needs to get some killing done with that Stormhammer. Sven is a hero that relies a lot on kills and levels in the early game. Arcade is going to be jumped on. They may be able to kill this guy. They are blocking him as much as possible, making sure he cannot go past through the trees. Arcade does pop his stick charge. Not going to be enough though, as he will burn down. Let's see Excalibur in the meantime. Double damage. He's just farming some trees. Leech is happening though for Milani. Just sitting. He's like, okay. Excalibur is trying to pull it as far away as possible, but I don't think he knows that Milan is here, so he's just going to have to deal with the fact that Milan is leeching a little bit of that ancient camp. Milan does have vision of this, so he can stay on until the creeps have been found, and maybe he can even go for kill on Excalibur, as it wouldn't be completely unusual. Oh, but Milan gets spotted out now. Now they go on and Root comes out. He gets his crush off either way though, as the CM is going to be taking down bonus for Excalibur, so he gets the ancient farm and he gets a kill on the CM in the process. Weaver in the bottom lane. Level 6. He has decent levels. He has good farm as well, actually. 34 last hits, but the Sand King is getting a good time in the lane as well as a trade-off. The CM, well, 6 last hits in the jungle. Not really the most successful jungling in the world. Guys, let's see what kind of movements do we have. Bad Rider trying very, very much to farm fast towards his Blink Dagger. He does have that extra little bit of mana region with the Arcane Aura from the CM. It is helping him on the way. Milan goes in for a little ward. J4 is on the move as well. They may want to try and set up on an extra kill on the Rubik, as they've killed him once, they can kill him again. Looks like they go for it, maybe a little bit deep, but they have the Root available from the CM. They will go for the Root. TP comes in from the tank here. Looks like the Batarang may have asked for a little bit too much. Arcade still alive. He does have his Fate Ball available. Not needed as the Coon TP's in. Sets up for a crit turnaround kill on that little Batarang in the meantime. Pablo goes in. CM is going to be the next one to fall. Looks like that is going to be an easy kill as Milan will indeed drop. Alright, two dead on the side of No Logic Gaming all of a sudden. Again, very, very nice rotations from the side of Horde as they just keep moving around. The Sand King, always ready to make rotations. He's always on the move, they're always trying to bait for kills, and it's successful. They get the kills they need, every single time.
Dire's bottom tower is under attack.
Alright, No Logic Gaming. Kind of off to a stale start this time around again, as they're 2.5k gold behind. They're almost 1000 experience behind as well. They're still trying to find kills. They may be able to get a kill on Gorg on that Morphling. He does have a waveform available in a second, in 2 seconds. Let's see, does he get it off? He tries to turn around, tries to go for waveform onto J4. He may have asked for a little bit too much, but the Firefly has ended, and so has the kill potential. So Gorg, he's not going to be punished for that. J4 He also survived, so, you know, wasting a lot of time. The Bad Rider is going to have to disengage a little bit. The Kuna, in the meantime, is going for a run. Gets a hit off onto Nikwa. He may continue for this kill as the slow is going to apply very soon, but he does not want to go for the kill. He could have very likely killed Nikwa, but he would have maybe had to pay with his life if TPs came in. So he's much better off just not going for the greedy style. The Sankey, in the meantime, does wait and see what the Bad Rider is doing, but he's not playing it greedy. He's not farming these two camps before he backs up. He will go deep into the trees, actually just go all the way back to his base and shrine up, heal up, and then he can go back where he came from.
Dire's bottom tower all right. is under attack.
Alright, Weaver gets a kill on the Slaughter, but the Slaughter got a kill on him first, so focus a little bit too greedy down the Weaver. Gets punished for it. That's a very happy Slaughter. Suddenly you just get level 6 given to you for free because the Weaver wants a kill on you. Very nicely done. Missed that one, sadly. Let's see how the farm is working. I'll see the net worth for now. Top net worth, TA, as per usual, a little bit ahead of the Shadow Fiend. The Weaver is ahead of the Morphling, not by a whole lot though, and the Sand King is ahead of the Batrider. Slaughter ahead of the Sven, so it's a very tight race from the two teams at the moment. Only 1,000 gold in favor of Horde after all, so it's very, very tight for the two teams. Alrighty.
Dire's top tower.
Let's see. Kuhn. Bounced a little bit in the mid lane. He is working towards his blink finally. He went for a lot of setup Dire's items first, but he will have it up in 1,000 gold. Nikwa, in the meantime, on the bad right, is only 500 gold away from his own blink, so he's going to potentially get it a little bit early. Arc is not going to be initiated on by Nikwa. He does have lift available, though, and looks like Nikwa, he's not going to repeat this story and die for it again, as he's so close to his blink, he does not want to lose it. They want to try and help him finish that farm. He will get a little bit more focused out in the meantime. Continues to push. They want to not let go of his power. The Kuhn is in position again. He goes in. He does have his bar spec available. Well, who does he go on? Kaiser is going to be the target. Epicenter comes out. He gets the Epicenter off. He's doing a lot of damage on the Kaiser. Kaiser is going to be dropping down. He tries for Requiem, but that is not happening. As Halter rotated everyone. They try to go. No bash, no stun, no nothing. The Slaughter doesn't have bash skilled up yet, so that is not happening. They lost the Rubik. They got the Shadow Fiend. So all in all, still very much worth it. Nikwa, he knew what was happening. He TP'd out instantly and just went to the mid lane, farmed out a little bit. As, like I said before, the thing about Bad Rider is when you're in this position, if you were to take the fight and die, then you would be pretty much just out of the game. Like, getting a too late a blink dagger on Bad Rider is not a good thing. It's very, very bad. So he needs to focus on the blink. He's 50 gold away from it. He cannot afford dying. Most likely won't, but Pablo's going to be on the run. He's trying to run him down. We do have Ake able to go for lift. That is going to be the setup on the bad run. He gets stunned up. Barstrack is available to get a two-man Barstrack off to kill the bad run before the blink is completed. That is the awful thing that can just not happen. Oh, 50 gold away, man. Oi, that hurts, man. That hurts deep in the soul. But that is life, man. Nikwa, you will have to farm a little bit more before the blink is completed. It is now 12 minutes into the game. It's not done yet with only Brown Boots alive. Weaver, Dragonlance, Aquila now rushing towards the Desolator. This game is fine, though, to have a Deso on the Weaver. So there's not two people going Deso. This Sven is trying to finish up a helm. Looks like he is very close to finishing it. Well, kind of close to finish it. The Shadow Fiend is trying to go for a Dragonlance himself. The CM is tranquilized for now. Nothing too unusual on top of that. And in the meantime, on the side of Horde, enough gold for the blink is up on the Kuhn. So he actually picks up a blink at the same time as the Bad Rider. And, well, that's what they were trying for. Now he's 1,000 gold out of the Bad Rider, so he's doing very nice for himself. The Morphling is rushing towards the Lincoln Sphere with his Aquila. He has Perseverance. He's pretty well farmed. Obviously, his farm is a little bit slower than the Weaver's, but the Weaver had a solo lane, so he had a lot more levels. And with a lot more levels, you should also get a lot more farm. That's the, you know, brain dead thing to say. The obvious thing to say. The Templar Assassin picked up his blink now as well. Still super farmed. Working towards the Desolator next. Slaughter working towards a blink. He needs 1,000 more gold for that. So All in all, it feels like Horde, they may try and set up for a fight with the Kun's Blink. They have it available in Excalibur. He's indeed pushing the bottom tower as they're sitting in the trees waiting with the Kun. He can initiate if someone tries to defend this tower, and that's the plan. In the meantime, the Logic Gaming, they are pushing the top lane. They're just fine with farming for now. They don't want to set up for anything that they don't feel like they can win, or they don't know where Horde is hiding, so they just go for push. They just continue pushing. They feel like it's very likely that they're not going to be in the top lane, so they do as much damage as possible. Tier 1 for tier 1 so far. And let's see, the Weaver continues pushing. The Shadow Fiend is going to be in position as well. They may be able to take this tier 2 as well as the fortification comes out. TP's coming from the side of Horde. They need to try and work on defending this. In the meantime, Sven comes in. Oh, Batrider goes for initiation onto the starter. The starter gets hit by two stun. Root is available as well. The Kun goes in, gets a jump on the CM, making sure the CM does not root anyone, but starter has already been taken down. Arcane the backline is a little bit in trouble. His focus over doing a lot of damage. Sven comes out. Oh, and the hit! So much damage done, as he did not expect to die from that one hit from the Templar Assassin. 2 for 2 so far. In the meantime, Case is going to be the next one to be jumped on. He goes for a Rec Room, blows it up. Excalibur still alive, slows Case even further. They need to continue going. J4 tries to stop Excalibur from moving away. Lift comes out. J4 is going to be taken down, but him losing his life to make sure the Shadow Fiend lives is a small price to pay. 3 for 2 in the end, so Horde, they win a small engagement. Now in the mid lane, Nikra, still no lasso available, he cannot go for another fight, but it's fine, you know, he just took a little corrosive haste to the face, so they have some vision on him for a moment. The Sand King, he died in that fight as well, so he didn't really go much further. The Bad Rider is actually sitting on a decent amount of farm suddenly, as he picks up his Tranquils, picks up his Wand. All in all, pretty decent. Picks up Windlace. So he has all of those early game items you want on a Batrider. Now it's just about getting forced off, potentially an Eels afterwards. And we'll see how this guy's game is going to go further. I guess Eels is kind of not the best item this game. Maybe a Ghost Up instead because you're playing against TA. But we'll see how he decides to go for it. The Weaver. Desolator up in 100 gold. Alright, the Templar Assassin puts down the trap. He does see Focus Dota here, but the trap got taken away by the looks of things, so he does not want to jump. His own Desolator is going to be completed in a moment as well.
A golden thread.
And let's see the Sea Focus. They do have the Sand King available. They could maybe think about getting a jump on this Weaver, as he's using a lot of time farming this doubled stat camp, so they could set up with a Borrow Strike into an Epicenter. Focus Dota uses his. Alright, he continues farming, but they're going to be a little bit stale. Yeah, they don't want to commit for this.
You died nobly.
I mean, I don't know if they could have. They needed the Epicenter for sure on top of the Borrow Strike, but I think they had enough damage to kill him there, if they at least tried. I guess he just didn't want to waste his Epicenter in case the Weaver was like instantly, you use Epicenter, then he like goes to Kuchi and walks away. That would have been a little bit sad, but in the end, they get nothing. They lose the Rubik in the meantime in the mid lane. So Horde, they need to be a little bit more consistent. Like, either you go for the play or you don't go at all. Like, you can't just wait and wait and wait and then let the creeps be farmed and then just, like, still look when it ends. Rubik now TP's in. Batrider's in position. Invis rune is available. Milan. Oh, Aki, sorry. Will be a little bit in trouble, maybe. He tries to steal something. Stole God Strength from J4. Not really the most amazing steal in the world. Case in the meantime is trying to finish up Roshan. They have a Replicate in the pit. Now they see the Roshan is super, super low. And they will make sure that at least Roshan is not going to be taken. Oh, the Morphling's Replicate got taken away. They may be able to take this Roshan in the end. See, Halt, do they try to contest it? The Blink is completed by the slaughter. He has it on the way, but they need to go before that happens. In the meantime, the Sand King gets jumped on. They try to finish Roshan. In the meantime, they finish the Aegis. Requiem of Soul comes out from Kesa. Looks like the Sand King will be burning down. He's so low, but the Kun, does he survive? High ground. Oh, they miss. They miss, but no, he doesn't get the Blink away, as the Kun will drop down on the Sand King. CM for Sand King. They get Aegis on the side of No Logic Gaming. They get a little bit back their way. Abusing that early Desolator on Focus Dota's Weaver, he's now moving towards a Lingen Sphere. Case's Shadow Fiend. Yasha is done, Dragonlance. Now, the next item will be his Manta style. Makes sense, you want to be able to Manta dodge that Corrosive Haste. Super annoying spell to deal with otherwise. You could get a BKB, but the Manta style is like the greedy option as Case. He's having a decent game. His farming is very, very nice, so there's no reason he shouldn't do that. Pablo does have a Blink available, tries to go for Blink Initiation onto the Templar Assassin. Well, onto the CM, sorry, the CM on top of the Templar Assassin, what am I talking about? In the meantime, mid lane, oh, the Kuhn goes in, tries to go for a bar strike on the bad runner, misses. He may survive, but this is not looking good. They will be able to bring down the Sven. In the meantime, they're chasing for Kaiser. He has the Aegis, so they need to be careful. Aki goes in, gets the lift off, loses his life before he pops him. The Aegis will be taken down. As Skork has to back himself up, they do have a slow available. The Kuhn goes in, but he gets killed in the backlands. So as Focus goes in, gets the double hit off, and the Kuhn will die where he's standing. Kaiser will still lose his life. Focus though, again, trying to find more kills. He finds the kill on the slaughter. He's now moving towards Gorg. Gorg will go for TP back home. Excalibur is going to be the one he focuses on. There's not a lot of mana on Excalibur. He needs to get the blink away. He goes invisible. Will survive for the moment. The Sven comes in. Does have dust available, but the blink away from Excalibur will be alive for the moment. He does have a trap. He tries to slow him. Is it going to be enough? He slows him, He has a shrine heal available. He will be able to pop the shrine. Uses refraction and he will survive. Oh, as I say that though, here comes the rest of the team. They should be able to get this kill on Excalibur in the end as Ake tries to come in from the side and help Excalibur. Not happening though, as Ake will die as well. The Sanking TP's in, but they may lose him as well if they know he's here. As this is just one by one Dota Horde. They lose hero by hero by hero. Now Gorg comes in on the Morphling, does get a kill on the CM. Barstrike comes out on the J4. Sven in the meantime, he's taking a lot of damage here as well. They need a couple more hits and J4 will burn down as well. Gorg gets a double kill. Oh well, one side gets too greedy, the other side gets too greedy in return as Horde and No Logic Gaming, they're both just fighting and fighting and fighting. It's a bloodbath in both ways. Alright. Whew, guys, that was a lot of blood being spilled on both sides. The Kuhn, Link, looks like he has another item completed. Just the Staff of Wizardry working towards his 4 staff. Slowly, Lingen's Fear is down on the Morphling, working towards his Ethereal Blade. Will take him a little while, though. Looks like the Templar Assassin does have his Blink there, so working towards a BKB next. So, hope they still have a lot of big items they need to wait for before they feel super confident fighting. The Slaughter's Blink is a great item, but it's one of many they need to be able to fight confidently. TA fighting up against Battle Rider without BKB is always a very risky thing to do. And let's see in the mid lane, they do jump the Weaver, they do burn him down as well. Between the lift from the Rubick, the Slaughter's Crush and all that good stuff, since the Weaver does not have Lingen's Fear just yet, it's very easy to combo stun him and kill him. The Templar Assassin, only the recipe to go for the BKB. Kaiser is very close to his Mantisal. The Sven, Helm of the Dominator is completed, working towards Treads next, as you can start becoming like a semi-carry on the Sven by now. Bad Rider, still no 4-star on him either, as he's working towards it. He does have his Blink available, could go on Excalibur, goes in, gets a lasso off again. The Kuhn tries to go in with a Power Strike, doesn't hit onto the Bad Rider. The Bad Rider gets control, CM goes for an ultimate, that's a lot of damage being done onto the Kuhn. The Kuhn gets hit by a Storm Hammer from J4 as well. Arceus steals the Freezing Field, turns it around, uses it against the enemy, but he may be a little bit in trouble here as J4, 3 seconds to go, then he has another Storm Hammer available. He will be able to go for the stun. J4 gets jumped on, gets crushed. Excalibur gets a nice, very, very nice side play hit off. Battle Rider will be the first casualty from him. J4, with that Warcry, they're still going to be alive now. Excalibur needs to dodge the Swarm in the meantime, let's see. They have heroes still available. Pablo gets hit by a Freezing Field, or well, a Crystal Nova, and he will die to Milan. Alright, nicely done from Horde. They buy back the Slaughter. They want to go for this fight. Excalibur goes in, goes for a jump. This is maybe too much though, as he's taking so much damage. Is he going to be enough to survive? No, he will die. He kills the Sven, but it's not worth giving up your life for that. As in the meantime, the Kuhn comes in with a bar strike. They get the kill on the Weaver. They need to chase more. They need a lot more. As they bought back the Slaughter for this, the Kuhn is on the wave. Link is ready in a few seconds. He needs to be the front line. They kill the CM. They continue going. CM. Morphling comes in with a replicate. The epicenter comes out on Kaiser. They need to continue going. Pablo flings forward, gets the crush off. Kaiser will drop on the Shadow. In the meantime, in the background, the Batarang tries to go on Aka. Aka will burn down. The Batarang gets lifted up in the meantime. They do have a bar strike available. They take the tower. They go for the bar. Batarang will be crushed out. He dies as well, TPing into his death. He kills the Rubick, but dying as an Orphaniner is not worth that.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
Alright, so the buyback was in the end worth it from Pablo, as he ends up securing a lot of kills for his team. Gorg, obviously, a lot of gold given to the Morphling in that fight as well. He will be able to finish his Ethereal Blade now, so he can pop someone very quickly. The Sand King, well, he's working towards his Eel Scepter by now. Slowly, still working on it. The Templar Assassin does have BKB in the next fight. Kind of unfortunate that Excalibur died in that fight, but he went a little bit too early for his team to be in position to make the counterplay work. Like, they still won the fight, but I'm sure Excalibur's idea that he was that he would just keep them there for a little while and then survive. His team comes in to the rescue, and then, you know, they turn around the fight, but he ends up dying. Slaughter, working towards a 4-star next, a Rubik. Well, nothing great on this guy. Maybe, did he pick anything up? Nah, just small items. In the meantime, on Logic Gaming, BKB is going to be the next item on case of J4. Kretz is done. Probably a Blink next, and then maybe he goes for something like an Armlet or BKB or whatever on this guy as well. As that's not unusual, even as a support Sven. Maybe Vlas, also a nice item. We'll see. Bad Rider has his 4-star completed now, the CM Glimmer Cape. Alright, let's see. Serial Blade is done. Tanky Morphling. Most likely picks up his travel boots next. They smoke up where they have sentry rewards, so they just made sure there was no vision on them, and then they smoke. J4 is going to be the first one they run into. The Coon goes in, gets a borrow off, will be lasted up by the batter. In the meantime, J4 takes a lot of damage, and that waveform comes out as well. Looks like Sven may be taking out Glimmer King, keeps him alive. He gets a nice 2-man storm ammo off. J4 is still going to be living. The Shadow Fiend got popped though, as the Sankey is the only casualty in the meantime. They kill the Sven as well. Milan is going to be the next one who gets initiated on. They try to kill him, the Glimmer King keeps him safe for moment, but they get the kill. 3 dead on side of No Logic Gaming. They got the Rubik in the back lines with the Weaver as well as the Bad Rider. So those two will survive. They'll move down towards the bottom area. In the meantime, the tier 2 in the mid lane will be pushed down by a Horn. Like both sides is just pushing and pushing and pushing, trying to fight, but it's always weird fights. Like the Sankey always goes in, he may get a Borrow Strike off, but then he dies afterwards. It's a very unfortunate mid game for Mr. Lacoon. He's had a very good early game, he had a very good game last time, but the mid game here is not really working out that great in his favor. As the tier 3 tower will now be taken down by Horde, they may continue going as there's still 15 seconds with no Shadow Fiend, and even when he's back he doesn't have full souls, so he doesn't really fight that well. Gorg takes a lot of damage from Focused Order, but not enough to scare him away from pushing that Melorax. They will take the Melorax. Now Weaver gets jumped on, Excalibur tries to do a little bit of damage onto him, blinks away. Alright, nice dodge with that Stormhammer. In the meantime, Nikwe goes in, Lasso's available in 1 second, doesn't have enough mana to use it, he does have to use his stick. Excalibur tries to turn around, but he does end up falling. Didn't have his BKB available on that TA, or at least he didn't want to use it, so... Gemla Assassin, nice little pick off from No Logic Gaming. They may be able to find more as they're looking for it, but looks like there's not really much more to find.
Dire's middle tower is under attack.
Alright, the TG down the mid lane in the meantime will be pushed down as the Shadow Fiend wants to turn around and create the favor. The Shadow Fiend gets jumped in the meantime, Borrow Strike comes out. Oh, he tries to go in with the Morphling with the Ethereal Blade shot on the Shadow Fiend, but he misses the Ethereal Blade on Kesa, hits it onto the Illusion instead. Oh, I don't even know. Hits it onto something else at the very least. In the meantime, Horde, they get overrun. Focus Dota goes in, gets a jump on the Sankey. Arcade dies on the Rubik as well. They lose the Slaughter. They're just getting overrun in that little fight. Morphling does have another Ethereal Blade shotgun available. Who does he go on? Bad Rider would be a nice one. He tries to go on and blinks away. No damage was done. Gorg. Flyback comes out from the Rubik. He may be able to keep the tower safe for long enough for his team to get back alive. 5 seconds left on that Templar Assassin. The Sanking is there for 20 more seconds. They need to defend this. Arcade goes in, pops the Lincoln Sphere and Focus Dota. Tries to scare him a little bit at the very least. Excalibur TP's in. He does have his BKB available. They could look for a jump. They go in. Kaiser does get jumped by Excalibur. That may be enough to burn him down. They go in with the Ethereal Blade. Gorg in the meantime gets hit by that Stormhammer in the face. Lincoln Sphere keeps him safe for now. Focus Dota needs to go for this kill. He has to go for the full on Morph Strength, but he's taking so much damage. Does he survive? They get the Borrow Strike on the Reaver just in time before Gorg died. Meantime, Epicenter came out, they almost burned J4. J4 dies. Bad Rider dies to the Ethereal Blade. Excalibur is on the hunt for the CM. The CM will die as well. He tries to go for the Melorax on Focus Dota. He will bring down the Melorax. In the meantime, the Lincoln gets popped. He does not have his time lapse available. He jumped, he gets killed. Oh, Gorg. Gorg died to the Beatles? Oh god, how does that happen? Especially like next to shrines, and like they use the shrine as well just now. How does he die like that? How does he die there actually? Oh well, Gog died on the Morphling, unfortunate. They still defended their base. They only lost the Metarak, so it's an even situation on both sides. Now Bad Rider goes for a buyback. He tries to go in and contest this Roshan, but they should be able to bring it down fast enough. They go in. Oh, he tries to go for the steal, not quite fast enough though. And now Nico may be a little bit in trouble. He fought back for this. This is not good. Losing your Bad Rider 60 seconds on the sidelines after using buyback. That is the Bad Rider's goal, just going down the drain. Necrot, that was not the play, man. Well, sometimes you try. I mean, I guess it's like, you know, you can always judge it afterwards, right? Because if he bought back, blinked in, took the Aegis, went out and survived with Aegis, you would be like, oh, what a player. So it's only like not the play when it doesn't work, right? Now the CM gets jumped on, tried to go out for a warding mission, but he gets comboed and he gets one shot by that Templar Assassin. So much damage in this guy right now. He has the Diffusion Blade completed again. He's working towards a butterfly like last game. Same build exactly. The Sand King in the meantime tries to see if there's anyone hiding in the trees. There's no one though. And let's see, they want to continue. The T2 got taken down. Now they want to go high ground. 30 seconds without CM. CM goes for a buyback. Port, they still want to commit as they have Aegis on Excalibur. Aki still working slowly towards those pink. They'll pack up for now. They can take the shrines as well. If need be, they can take the shrine very easily. Slaughter does have blue plus 4 stuff. Morphling, Ethereal Blade travels going towards a... Wait, what? Morphling? I'm sure that's like a Scotty or a Mantis style, and he's... Yeah, he actually sells these. He's like, what the hell am I thinking? I have a Lincoln Sphere. Why would I go for another Lincoln Sphere? He's moving towards a BKB instead, guys. So we already saw in the first game, Gog, like, having that double Desolator. So it wouldn't be surprising if he went for another not-so-good item purchase. But, yeah, we're just making fun of him, man. It's fine. We saw that, though. We saw that. He tried to get another Lincoln's. Do not hide. Alright, the Coon. Blink, falls, eels. Is done on this guy. Templar Assassin can buy his butterfly very, very soon. Should fit the timing where the Aegis is down, then he can replace it with a butterfly. And on the side of No Logic Gaming, BKB is done on the Shadow Fiend. 10 second BKB is up and available. Sven still moving towards his blink. 4 stuff is completed by the Batter. No eels just yet. The Weaver does have a BKB as well. 10 second available, moving towards a Bloodthorn next. Will take him a long time to finish that though. And the CM, not really anything great left. He just used the buyback, so obviously his net worth is kind of hurting. If we take a look at the overall net worth lead, we can see that Holt, they only have a 4,000 net worth lead, so it's not something that can't be fought against. But look at the experience, 12,000 experience lead. That is insane amounts of levels on the side of Holt. I'm not sure if this is like because of some kind of level perks, or if they just have a lot more experience overall. Maybe they, when they died, they lost a lot of gold. I guess that's what happened, right? Alright, so let's see what's happening. Lacking, okay. So the Coon will just go for a restart of Dota, I'm sure. So he will be back in like 30-ish seconds. It's not going to be a long pause, no worries, boys. See if Horde can finish up this game. They're so close. They can taste the victory, but there's still a couple of moves left to be made. No Logic Gaming, they can still try and defend high ground. They're not that far behind in terms of net worth. They have good late game heroes as well. The Weaver will always continue to scale, at least for a long time. The Shadow Fiend as well can still build a lot of big items. The Sven even, I mean, this is a ticking time bomb, right? Like, at some point, this guy is going to scale into heavy, heavy right-click items as well. Or just a lot of aura items. Either would be very good. The Bad Rider, well, he has two items, so it's not like his progression is going to stop anytime soon. And the CM, he has Glimmer Cave only, so No Logic Gaming, the longer the game goes on, the better it's going to be for them. Whereas Horde, I mean, the Templar Assassin, he is very close to being 6-slotted. Sure, you can replace the Diffusion Blade, you can get a Moonshot, you can replace the BKB, the Desolator with bigger items. But once you start replacing all of your items, like, the value of the gold you get is not going to be as big. Alright, let's see in the meantime. Well, Fing wants to get that BKB finished up. He only needs 800 more gold, but I'm not sure if you want to wait until the BKB is done before you go for another push. Looks like bottom lane, Focus Order is going to be the target they're walking down towards. They're just rushing him down. Paul, they want to get this initiation. They tried to go in for Blind Crush. Oh, they find him though. Focus Order will be seen. They walk through. They four-star forward. Focus Order is going to be spotted. He is invisible for now, but he goes on to Pablo. Pablo gets a bash off. Oh, the bash. Pablo just clicks him in the face and he's like, now what? Now what? In the meantime, mid lane, Gorg. Oh, so much control. He tries to replicate away, but Lasso falls into a point blank Rec Room. That is a blown up Morphling. Almost survived, but almost is not good enough. So they lost a carry on each side. And let's see, Horde.
Radiant's bottom tower has fallen.
The tier 2 down the bottom end, they get taken down by Horde. Now they can take the shrine in the bottom area as well. So even though the Morphling is dead, they can pretty much secure him the gold for the BKB while he's dead by taking structures. The Sand King does have a gem on him now purchased by Mr. Pablo's Slaughter. Pablo doesn't really need any more items at the moment anyways. The Rubik does want to get his blink up, maybe? Nah, he goes for Ghost of instead, so that's the survivability item against the Weaver, I suppose, and the Shadow Fiend, just so he can make sure he at least gets a couple of spells off before dying. Slaughter could also go for Ghost of himself, so both of them could survive a little bit longer. There's no Diffusal Blade at the moment on the side of No Logic Gaming, so the Ghost of would be very valuable. Let's see, bottom lane, Weaver. Moves in, the Sand King is in position, already just sandstorming his way through things. Focus Dota does hit him a couple of times in the meantime. Weaver goes for another pause, okay. Unfortunate, in the meantime, top lane looks like there's a Rubik being dragged by a Batrider. They want to kill this guy. Alright, CM, well, I mean, these two should be easily be able to kill the Rubik. There's no way this guy should survive. Milan, old Frostbite, freezing field, and then they can go completely crazy on that guy. Alright guys, they're ready to go again. Let's continue bottom lane. The Weaver just gets jumped, doesn't get barred. Oh, the Coon goes into his death as he misses the barrage strike and he pays with his life. That is a gem on the ground as the Weaver will gladly take that away from him. Sand King making small mistakes and he's being punished for it. The Coon is having a rough time at the moment. He's used all of his energy already, and if they go to game 3, I'm not sure if he can keep up, as they need to end this game before all of the energy of the Coon is gone, man. The Boros are one Bor after another, it's just not going well. Alright, Pablo. Kembla Assassin does have that Aegis still, does have his butterfly completed now, so I would imagine they are still looking to use the Aegis for something, but they need to wait for the Sand King to respawn. He's now back up. Let's see if they gather up and go for a push somewhere. The Templar will push out the mid lane in the meantime, moves in. BKB still available. The Illusions get sent out by the Shadow Fiend trying to defend this mid lane, but That is not going to be happening. Kesa will have to make do with his own power of defense. And let's see the Bad Rider get jumped four stops towards Excalibur. Excalibur actually got pushed away into the trees, but it's fine. He can just fling back. They get a jump on him and they kill him regardless. The Bad Rider is going to be in the grave for 60 seconds. They now want to try and go high ground, but they don't have the Aegis anymore. Excalibur, he wasted that opportunity. They may still try though. Looks like Kesa got slowed by the trap on the high ground. Let's see Excalibur move in. Goes for a jump. Pre-grade will be taken away in a few seconds. And Excalibur now blinks towards the top area. Do they go for the tower? Yeah, Excalibur, he wants to just commit for that tier 3 tower. They will try and force it down. Blink comes hit, but in the meantime, Excalibur blinks out. Not really the best initiation in the world. In the meantime, the Shadowfiend gets hit by an ETH blade. He will be alive. BKB gets popped. Kesa is still fine, but he gets popped. He doesn't get his Requiem off before dying. He is now dead. Focus Auto continues fighting. Gorg, he just goes for that more strength. He still has a little bit of value left. He needs to be careful with his HP though. We'll find out. J4 goes for a buyback on the Sven. SF does have a buyback available as well, but the CM is dead. The Bad Rider is still dead for 5 seconds. They need to wait for the Bad Rider. They now buy back the Shadow Fiend. They have to go in. They have to defend this. Looks like Horde, they're fine with backing up. They force a buyback from the Shadow Fiend. That is good enough. They don't want to overcommit for something else. They now have the buyback on cooldown on the Sven, the Shadow Fiend. So everything is good. They can just go back, they can regen, they can even just smoke again if they wanted to and then try and find initiation. They just need to kill the Shadow Fiend, then they could end the game. So we'll see if they can manage to do that. Item wise, let's see. Next BKB is available in the second. They do buy smokes on the side of No Logic Gaming. They use two very huge buybacks, so it makes sense if they were to go for like a fireman desperation smoke as well. They are now 10,000 gold behind. They are 20,000 experience behind, so they need to find a pickoff. They need to find one desperately to prolong the game. The Weaver picks up a little arcane rune. He now TP's back to the base just to heal up fully. Almost has the Scotty completed on top of that BKB just purchased a second ago mid lane. In the meantime, the Templar Assassin gets down. The smoke. Smoke was a success. Horde. That Templar Assassin got jumped and they were not ready to help him. He gets burned down instantly. He does have buyback available, so they can buy back if necessary, and it's very likely it will be necessary. The Morphling is trying to split push in the bottom and can TP him whenever necessary. T2 down the top lane, looks like that's what No Logic Gaming wants, but if they use too much time not forcing high ground, they may not be able to go for anything at all. I mean, I understand why you would go for tier 2, because then you can go for both the top racks as well as the bottom ones, but I don't know, they're wasting a lot of time. Like 60 seconds to go with the T8, there's backdoor protection for now, so they will waste another 10 seconds. In the meantime, the Morphling is pushing the bottom lane, so they may even have to just completely stop this push. And that is what happens, so they can't even force the TA to buy it back. They may be able to jump Gorg here. He needs to get himself out of here. He does not have a replicate available, Gorg. If he dies, then it's worth it. Then they can go right back and try and force the Morphling's buyback instead, which is, by the way, not available. Alright, this could be very bad as Gorg, man, he's baiting his heart out. We do have the Kuna on the way towards the bottom area as well. He does have his Ebon available, but I mean, what would you try to successfully do? The issue right now is that, yeah, they actually have a problem. They can't go on him. That's actually so sad. Gorg, he should be able to survive because he has BKB, so he can make sure they can only do right click damage, plus Nikwa cannot use Lasso on him right now. His 4 staff is on cooldown. He needed to use the 4 staff to get close enough to him. And he has Lingen Sphere available, so there's no one who can pop the Lingens nearby. The Sven does have a blink available, so he can, yeah, I guess he's close enough to blink Stormhammer and then they can get the Lasso off. But I'm not sure if that's going to be good enough. The Morphling could even use the BKB to dodge the Sven's Stormhammer. And then in that case, if he times it, he can maybe bait out the Lasso from Nikwa. I'm sure that's actually the best play he can try and go for, is that J4, he goes in, he blinks forward, he uses a Stormhammer, and then like the second before it hits, you pop BKB, and you hope that Nikwa tries to use the Lasso at the same time. In that case, he would use the Lasso on the Lingens, and then you will probably survive, no problem. We'll see. We'll see what Gork decides to do. I mean, when you pause, you suddenly have a lot of time to think about your next move. A little bit, maybe a little bit unfair in some ways, but if people lag, people lag. Alright, let's see. Pops his BKB, goes for TP back home. That's another way to do it. Just BKB TP out. Don't even try and waste any time. He will be fine. Alright, so what happened here was basically that No Logic Gaming, they decided to push the tier 2 tower in the top lane. They tried to fight the backdoor protection, ends up not getting the tower because the Morphling has to pressure them so hard that they have to defend, they have to TP back and defend. Meaning that No Logic Gaming, they use buyback on the Shadow Fiend as well as the Sven like 2 minutes ago. They tried to pressure for the buyback of the TF after killing him with the smoke, but they didn't actually get to do that. So the Templar Assassin did not get punished, he still has his buyback available. Usual 2 has been purchased as well, and the Morphling has had enough time to finish up his own buyback goal so he doesn't get into a weird situation where he doesn't have buyback. See what No Logic Gaming has completed. Blink is soon up on the CM. The Weaver does have that gem on him that he took away from Pablo. He does have an MKB complete as well. No buyback right now, but that's a lot of damage. The Batrider picked up a BKB just now. The Sven, Blink, Helm working towards a BKB himself. A Void Talisman is completed by the Shadow Fiend, almost having a butterfly completed. Alright guys, the Kun is back for the maybe like the 100 millionth time, but you can always hope that this one is the last time. Alright. Guys, we are ready to go. Boss has ended, let's see. Oh, they're moving up, they're gathering up together. They do have a smoke available, I believe, on the Rubik Yandy. They have a smoke on him. They can TP Pablo back as well. He has another smoke, so they can go for a couple of smoke plays. They need to try and find that pickoff on the Shadow Fiend in the meantime. No logic gaming. They do the same play as they did a second ago where they called the TA. They went, they go for Fireman smoke. They need to catch something. They need to keep on prolonging the game. Roshan is very, very soon up. Very, very soon up. And yeah, well, while that is up and available. Just buying time until my head dies again. Not fooling me. Alright. Let's see. Looks like no logic gaming is fine, I guess J4 just quickly went to the toilet or something like that while the Kun was gone anyways. Either way, let's see. They go for that fireman smoke. They're trying to find a jump on someone. Horde puts down a little trap with the TA so they know roughly where the TA is. Let's see if they can get that jump. They need to get that TA kill desperately. Excalibur does move himself towards the mid area. He could be jumped here. Nikra. Oh, he moves the other way though. They guess wrong. They may find Gawk in the meantime, but they don't get the jump. They now know that no logic gaming, they're in position. They fling away on the Kun, but he gets flunked on by this Batterer. They jump him, they find the kill on him. Looks like Horde, they're just going to disengage themselves. This is not a good position to fight in, but Arke has already been spotted out. They want to get this kill as well. He puts down a Sentry Ward. Arke is going to be on the move. He tries to steal something, or he steals the Tsukuchi, but it's not good enough. As they have vision, they have a gem on the Batterer, obviously, so they get the Rubik kill as well. And what a time to get that. They are now forcing a buyback from the Sanky because they need to defend Roshan. They have a trap in the pit, so they know this is happening. They buy back with the Rubik as well as the Sand King. The courier dies from the Radiant, actually. Thing up. Alright, let's see in the meantime. Roshan is not going to be happening. No logic gaming. They back themselves up, but they're not going to be on a chase. 17 seconds to go, then they cannot go for another lasso. They need to continue catching people. In the meantime, bottom lane Morphling is doing his thing. He is forcing them back. Tier 3 tower may drop down, and he's doing so much damage to it. He does have his Replicate available. He will be jumped on. He does have a Lingan Sphere available, but he's fine. We'll get the Replicate away, and now they go for Roshan themselves. In the meantime, they force the Sven as well as the Weaver to come back and defend the high ground. So now Roshan is going to be an easy thing for them. They take it. Aegis gets picked up by Gawk on that Morphling. They now jump on the Milan. CM gets taken down. 50 seconds on the sidelines. Keza and Fogatoda, they're both moving themselves back to the base as they cannot contest this Rosh anymore. Very nicely played by Gawk, just forcing people back. You have two choices, you need to make one. Like, either you go for Roshan, and you probably, well, you could probably get Roshan. Maybe you take a fight and then, you know, no one knows what happens. But in the meantime, they would lose the Rax in the bottom lane. So it's kind of a difficult situation when you know logic gaming. The best thing to do is just defend, make sure you don't lose any buildings. And then if you lose Aegis because of that, well, then it's kind of hard to do anything else. It's better to just try and defend high ground rather than potentially give up both buildings as well as Aegis. Alright, let's see how in the meantime they smoke up. They're ready to jump. There's no tier 3 buildings, so they should be able to make a very, very nice jump on the high ground as well. The shrine in the mid lane has already been used now as well by Mr. Nikwa. So let's see, they're just hanging themselves back. Excalibur is the only one showing. He's going to be the frontliner. They want to get a jump on him regardless, so I'm sure they want to try and look for a jump. Pablo is going to be in the front. Nikra takes a Lingan Sphere to his face from Focus Dota as they want him to go in and find a jump on someone. Let's see if he finds anything. Nikra's ready for it. They have a ward spotting him out, though. They know that the batter at a sailing position there. The Kun goes in, sees the CM. Sandstorm comes out, Glimmerkeem comes out as well. Both of them is like, okay, don't jump me, don't jump me, don't jump me. But it's fine for now. No one jumps anyone. Alright, the tension is pretty heated up. They have another smoke available by Arke. They TP away on the Morphling. As he TPs down to the bottom, he starts pushing out that. In the meantime, I'm sure that no logic gamer should try and look for a jump. There's a Replicate available from the TA that was Nikwe tried to go in, but didn't actually work. Gawk, in the meantime, is continuing his push. This replicate will be sent away as you don't want to give up that replicate. You need to keep it alive. Alright, let's see, they jump in, they get a jump on the Weaver. Doesn't actually do anything. The Morphling is still pushing the bottom and Gog. May go and force high ground here, as he does have that replicate available. They may try and jump him in the meantime. Gog goes in, starts hitting the Melorax, goes in on the CM, pops the CM, replicates to the top end. Now they can go for the push in the top area as the CM is dead, fires back instantly. Liquid goes in on the Batrider, gets a lasso on that Templar Assassin. They may be able to burn him down. Excalibur has to pop his BKB, but it's not good enough. He will be taken down. Excalibur is dead. 100 seconds on the sidelines. In the meantime, Horde is being overrun. Rubik gets taken down. TP back on Gorg. He will survive. The Kuhn may not be so lucky. He tries to go for TP out as well, but the MKB procs from Focus Order. Sand King will die as well. 50 seconds. Pablo, in the meantime, in the bottom lane, tried to push out this, but it's a Slaughter support. There's only so much damage you can do. Morphling is in the bottom lane as well, as he knows what he has to do. He has that Aegis. Even if he loses the Aegis, maybe even if he loses his life, it's better to try and split push and force something, because you don't have buyback on the Sand King and the Rubik, and you do not want to use the buyback on the TA, so the need to split push this up. Let's see if they can force back No Logic Gaming. In the meantime, No Logic Gaming is running down the mid lane. They could go down mid and just try and force Throne, try and force Rax somewhere. But who's pushing faster? I don't know. The Morphling is pushing quite damn fast. Looks like in the meantime, No Logic Gaming, they want to go for that Throne push. It's funny because it's true. Alright, well, this is going to be interesting. I mean, I guess this is maybe No Logic Gaming's best chance, if they feel like, because what would you do otherwise here, right? Like you can take the Rage Tracks, you can go down to bottom, you can try and push that out. They do have both Weaver as well as the Shadow Fiend on high ground very soon. Those two push insanely fast. Probably even faster than the Morphling. In the meantime, the Morphling can take the set of racks in the bottom lane and try and go back and defend. They do have that buyback on the Templar Assassin after all, so they need to back up quickly. The Slaughter will most likely quickly TP, and well, they can TP on the Morphling as well, so we will have a high ground defense, but No Logic Gaming, this is pretty much saying, well, if we try to commit for Throne, we will force the Morphling back, and then either we can back up or we can 5v5 fight, and then in case Horde were to lose that fight, then suddenly you can take the game. So No Logic Gaming, there may be gambling, but it may pay off. Alright guys, let's all pray and hope for the Kuhn's internet to repair itself somehow. And whoever's DDoSing him, please stop it so we can end this second game. And well, no matter what happens, let's just be able to end the game before everyone dies from boredom. That would be sad. We've been almost been paused longer than the game has gone on. That's where we are at the moment, so feels bad, man. Kuhn should be back in a moment for another attempt. I told him to not leave his home, but he wouldn't listen. GG. Owned. Alright, he's back, boys. Ready? Ready? Everyone is ready. Cool. Alright, boys, let's see how the split push happens. Top mid lane, looks like they are indeed going for the throne. They want to just end this game. They have to buy back the Temple Assassin. TP comes back on top low. Let's see. Wall building has been taken down, the Metarax has been taken down as well, so if they can defend this, that's going to be very good. The Sven gets jumped on, takes an Ethereal Blade shot to the face, and the Sand King disconnects again. Someone save me. Save me. Alright, well, I guess, like, guys, someone kill this guy, man. Kill that Sand King, right? Alright, so the Sven, well, he's not going to die from the waveform, but he's going to take a lot of damage. So let's see, Morphling does have that Aegis available, so I'm sure he just wants to try and right-click people to death. I mean, they did use the fortification, they will lose a tier 4 tower, but they took a Melorax in return. The Raintrax is being worked on by the creeps, so as long as they can defend this horde, they will have won the trade-off as well. They will maybe lose the Raintrax in the mid lane and a tier 4 tower, but they will get a Metarax in the bottom lane as a trade-off, so they will have two lanes that pushes in towards No Logic Gaming, and the top lane has been pushing in a little bit, well, slowly. What is it? Ah, it's actually being pushed. Yeah, it's pushing in, so. See? First things first, though, the Coon. Let's all pray, let's all group up together, buy internet for him. I don't know. Pings is happening like crazy. Kind of understandable though. I mean, you just bought back the Templar Assassin. You know he's moving in. You know he's trying to jump someone. No Logic game. They're like, okay, our Sven is almost dead. He is very much in trouble. He has Warcry available, but how do we take this fight? Like, this is what you would think about when you're post up in this situation. This is the GG fight, right? This is the moment where either No Logic Gaming, they're going to continue being behind, or they can turn around and forced it to a game 3, so you need to think about every possible thing to make it work. I mean, right now, if I can just like say what happens, right, is that the Sven will obviously pop Warcry, he will use his wand, he will try and Stormhammer the Morphling in the meantime may pop his BKB. I don't think you want to pop your BKB before you use Aegis though, so he'll probably just right-click Kesa. Kesa will pop his Manta, he will try and burst down the Morphling a little bit, and Milan does have a Glim available, he can use that on the Sven to keep him alive, and Bogazoro probably just continue hitting the buildings for now. Maybe take the range rack quickly so this little annoying clump of metal gets out of the way. And let's see. The Replicate is also moving back towards the base, so I guess they can maybe try and bait a little bit with that. Maybe kill the courier with it. I'm not sure how much Replicate's damage is. 116 damage. Not quite enough to kill the courier. He needs 2 hits on it. I mean, maybe. Maybe. The Replicate can bash as well, as far as I believe, so if he bashes, he can kill a courier. Alright guys, please, the Coon, come back. All right. Sand King, Sand King, where are you, Sand King? Israeli internet, indeed. All right, looks like he's back. Hopefully this is going to be last time because they have pretty much used up all of their what's it called, all of that pause time for sure. So there's no way that he can continue this AFK pause, AFK pause, AFK pause. We'll see the Sven get jumped by the Morphling. Here comes Pablo. He does get a good crush off. He does get the crush on the CM though. Focus out against control as well. He's maybe a little bit in trouble. They do pop the Aegis on the Morphling. He will respawn in a couple of seconds. The TA is ready to go in for a jump. Kaiser's going to be the target. They need to jump. They need to burst him down. Kaiser gets jumped. BKB gets popped. But the lasso comes out either way on the TA. They may be able to burn him down. They burn down Excalibur. That's a fireback used on the TA. Gox, he goes in further. J4 is going to be his target. He will burn him down. They need to catch Kaiser though. They need the big kills. Let's see, the Sand King is going to be on Hunt. He gets an eel set off. Epicenter comes out as well. He wants to get Kaiser. He gets a jump on him and he should burn him down as well. That is a Shadow Fiend with no buyback, dead for 110 seconds. So despite the TA dying, they should still be able to get to call this a victory. They do see Nykra as well. They're running him down, but I'm not sure if you even bother with this kill. You could maybe just try and focus on the Rax. I mean, focus on, in the meantime, is pushing the mid lane. And in the base, we do have Gorg doing the work on the buildings as he will take down the range Rax. The Shadow Fiend actually gets enough gold to go for a buyback. He only needed a couple of gold pennies to buy back. Now he will use that buyback. In the meantime, the Weaver does take down one of the shrines, does a little bit extra damage to the base, and they bring down the Batrider in the top lane. The little gang squad with the Sand King as well as the Slaughter, they may be able to go in and force another push, but the Morphling, he uses Aegis, he doesn't have Aegis anymore. He's sitting on 6,000 gold conversion by another item. The Slaughter, almost enough for Shadow Blade. They need to keep on going as well. They put a lot of pressure, they forced the Shadow Fiend's buy back, so it's in a pretty decent situation right now. I just need to keep it up. Fortune. So many buybacks on cooldown. Alright, well, the Aegis got used instantly on the Morphling. He's level 25 now as well, so he does have that replicate damage available. Shadowfiend takes a little E-Blade shot to the face, does a lot of damage to him as well. Kind of surprising he didn't try to Manta dodge it, but either way, he will just be sent on his way with that Morphling. The Morphling, with 6,000 gold, I mean, what do you buy? Just a butterfly on him? Or do you buy something bigger in terms of like survivability, like a satanic, because you're very worried about dying this game, like for sure. So we'll see. The Sand King can pick up a Lingen Sphere for himself. He does have enough gold to finish it, but he also has buyback off cooldown in 10 seconds. Okay, he decides to just go for the Lingen Sphere purchase. So they have two Lingen Spheres, well, three Lingen Spheres. No, two Lingen Spheres actually. What am I talking about? There's no Lingens on the TA. I thought he had one as well. Slaughter does have a gem on him as well. Shadowblade is complete. They smoke up inside of hole. They're moving down bottom with the Morphling. Still sitting on that 6,000 gold. I'm not sure what you would want to do with it. The focus sort of runs in to the enemy team though. Pablo goes in, doesn't get the crush off. Nikwa tries to go for initiation with the lasso. He goes in, tries to get lasso off. Gets the lasso on the TA. The TA gets control. They need to burn him down. Do they get the kill again? Excalibur will be taken down. Nikwa will burn on the battle in the meantime. That is one for one so far. Shadowfiend gets the spread room off. Here comes the Sand King though. Epicenter comes out. The Shadowfiend is going to be taken down next. Goes for his Mantis style. Will die in the end. That is 3 down on No Logic Gaming, 3 down on Horde. The Morphling continues fighting. He does go for TP back, but no, the Bash! Bash from Focus, he gets the Bash off on the Morphling. Self-E-Blade on the Morphling will keep him alive for the moment. He goes for a long stun on the Weaver. In the meantime, he gets the waveform away. He needs to survive this. Does he survive? Ake tries to... Oh, so close, man. Ake now tries to go for TP back home. He will survive, but he needed to keep the Morphling alive. He needed to get another stun off on him, and in the end, that is not going to be good enough. The Morphling does have a buyback available, but there are three people dead. This is troublesome. No Shadow Fiend though, so it's only going to be the Weaver that can push, and the Morphling can buy back and just force him away. So let's see how much damage the Weaver can do in the meantime. The Sand King is going to be back up in 8 seconds as well. 10 plus as in 40 seconds. So I'm not sure how much damage the Weaver can really do. He needs to wait for the Creep Wave to be available. He's just on him now. Ake goes in, steals the Sakuchi, lifts him up, controls him for a little while. Tries to just zone him away as much as possible. Steals the Sakuchi again just to make sure he has that spell available. Alright, Sand King loses his connection once again. Alright, the Coon, they are going to play 4 versus 5 as well. They've used all of their pause time. They've paused for like roughly like 25-ish minutes. So Horde, they can't really rely anymore on it. It's a little bit sad that you don't have your 5th player there, but not much else to do about it. The Sand King will be controlled by someone else. They go in, they're gonna jump on the Weaver, they control him, they do a lot of damage. Lift comes out on him. They're taking a lot of damage on this Weaver. They go for the time lapse, but the time is being wasted. They're not buying back on the mob. He pops his BKB, tries to force down that Tiffy building, but the BKB is going to end very, very soon. He only got the tower. They're going to be fine with that. I mean, losing a tower is not too bad compared to not having to use the buyback on the Morphling. And let's see, 20 seconds to go, then the Morphling is back up. The Templar Assassin has respawned as well. It's kind of difficult for the Templar at the moment. Him being lassoed every single fight has led into him dying. They need to get a jump on the Batrider to be able to win the fights properly, the Coon. Going to be in the back line, so obviously someone is controlling him, so he's going to be the last one going in the fights most likely. And let's see, Lingen's Fear gets used on the Templar Assassin. He has an extra Lingen's courtesy of the Sand King, so we'll see.
That's exact.
Let's see. Looks like the butterfly is going to be picked up by the Morphling. At least he wants a talisman activation. I mean, I'm not sure what kind of big items he's going to buy, but looks like it's going to be something like that. Or not. He buys a Mantis Owl. Okay, that's also a decent item. Gives him a lot more stats so he can survive better. And, well, Manta dodging things is always useful. They now go for Roshan as well. They will pick up the Aegis on maybe the Templar Assassin. Yeah, the Templar Assassin picks it up. Makes sense because the last couple of fights, the Templar Assassin has been the one being lassoed every single time, and he dies when the lasso gets used. But now, since the lasso can only be used once in a fight, or well, at least unless the fight lasts for a long, long time, then he can use the Aegis for that, he can respawn, and then you should be able to have a much better time fighting. The Morphling is super goddamn fat as well, so he should not have an issue surviving with all of these items, but he needs to be careful regardless. And let's see what else is available. Cheese is also on the Templar Assassin, so he has a lot of defensive items on him right now. He's working towards an MKB next. In the meantime, the Logic Gaming, Shadow Fiend, Mantastall on him, Butterfly, he's working towards a Satanic. The Sven has Blink Solar Crest available, so small, cheap, very, very cost-effective items. The Batrider's very close to finishing his Aghanim set. They can buy it out, would not have buyback available, but he will have buyback in a moment, so that is going to happen very soon. That means two lasso targets if they're close to each other. Weaver as well, Butterfly completed, MKB completed. This guy is insanely fat as focused. Almost the same amount of net worth as the Morphling. The Morphling still doesn't have an MKB. That's the next item you have to worry about, as there's Butterfly and both the Shadow Fiend as well as the Weaver, so they need to worry about that. Let's see, Horde, they move up on the high ground with Pablo. Scouting out a little bit, hiding in the trees. That could be sneaky, but he needs to be careful in the meantime. While he's just picking himself, he's like, guys, I'm ready to go in for a jump. I'm just sitting in the trees, but the Batrider could be spotted in the meantime. He goes in, he sees. Oh, do they see each other? Slaughter. Does he get a jump on him? Oh, Pablo, he sees him. He should be. Maybe he goes for a jump here. He will move himself away. He will go invisible. He does not get hit by the Stormhammer. In the meantime, he can blink back in and try and jump on the Batrider, which is something you need to do. You need to control that bat. But let's see, Horde, they're just holding themselves back for now. Waiting and waiting and waiting. They don't want to commit for something they don't have to. And I'm not sure how that buyback is. They have the buyback available on the Sand King as well. If we take a look at the overall buyback status, let's see. There's buyback on... You need buyback on the Sand King as well as the Slaughter. That's the two heroes that don't have buybacks on. In the meantime, the Shadow Fiend's buyback is now available again. CM needs 1500 more gold for his buyback. The Sven needs 1000 more for his. The Weaver has buyback available in a second as well. So it is buyback versus buyback gaming. The Aegis is up for another 3 minutes on the side of Horde. So they most likely want to try and use it We just need to see how much they wait until they actually do. They may wait for the full 5-man squad to have buybacks available. If they were to do that though, they need to give farm to the Sand King as well as the Slaughter, but for now, they're just going to push. The Morphling, double damage available, at least the remainder of it, so he could maybe just go high ground and look for something. Pablo looks to go high ground. Lane gets cancelled, he tries to pop the CM, in the meantime the Sand King borrows himself out. Nice 2-man crush comes out, Excalibur goes in, tries to go for a pop on the CM, the CM takes a lot of damage, Lazo comes out on Excalibur, Excalibur will lose his life. That's the Lazo, that's the Aegis, in the meantime the Ranger gets focused on Grog, takes a lot of damage, will replicate himself away. In the meantime Excalibur is still alive for the moment, needs to get himself out of here as well. Epicenter got used by the Sand King in the meantime. Kesa, very, very low BKB has been popped. They're still alive on the side of No Logic Gaming, but they've lost the range rack. They get the Sand King kill. They pop the Aegis. They get the Rubik as well. That's two people dead on the side of Horde. Morphling in the trees does get the TP back to the bottom lane, so he survives. Excalibur survives as well. They lost so much though. Lost two heroes again. They barely get the range racks, and I mean, there's still buildings alive on the side of No Logic Gaming. They have the melee racks. They wanted to get full mega creeps, but it's not good enough. Alright, let's see. The Sand King will be back up in 10 seconds. So, no worry, no one has to use buyback on the side of 4. They're worried about pushing out the lanes for now. The Templar Assassin, does he have that MKB complete? Yes, it's done now, so his MKB is going to be ready. He has the cheese available as well, but I'm not sure if you want to have the cheese rather than having the MKB in your storage. In the meantime, Radiant Courier dropped down. That's 2,400 gold on it, probably just a Demon Edge. And let's see, they are smoked up, they're moving in, they're trying to find a jump on someone. Morphling is going to show himself. Nikra does have a lasso available. Do they get the jump on him? The Weaver will move in towards him. He does go through him. Gorg is a little bit in trouble. DKB is available, but no, he gets jumped on, he gets controlled, he gets killed. He does have buyback available. That's a very nice pick off on the side of No Logic Game. They can continue, they will force the buyback instantly. And let's see, in the meantime, do they get run down? They try to blink out. Pablo goes for blink, does not get the crush off though. Nikra in the meantime, 37 seconds before his next lasso. They have used those lassos so insanely well on that Bad Rider, as that has led into a kill every single time. And they force a very, very big buyback in the Morphling. Morphling does have a refresh shell purchase as well. I'm not sure why you would even buy a refresh shell. Like, that's kind of weird to me, that Morphling's items. Like, you would probably rather replace the BKB with like a Satanic, so you use the BKB, then you replace the items in the middle of the fight, then you can replace Boots of Travels with an MKB, but Refresh Orb, I'm not so sure. I mean, double Replicate, is that really worth it? I don't know. I guess with the 50% bonus Replicate damage, it's decent if you replicate the Shadow Fiend, but that requires that you do get to replicate the Shadow Fiend, right? All that, he can replicate himself as well, I suppose. Mantan then replicate one of the Mant illusions. That illusion would, in that case, do a lot of damage. He doesn't really have the best backclick items though, and now Horde, they're moving in, they're trying to find a jump on someone. They are smoked up. In the meantime, the Logic Game, they go for a smoke themselves, so smoke on smoke action. The CM will be the first one to blow up. The Coon will be spotted here. He's a little bit in trouble. They're going for Lasso. The Coon is trying to counteract, trying to go on the bad run. In the meantime, the tier will be blown. He does have buyback available. Looks like the Coon is going to drop down as well, as that Sand King is very much in trouble. Sand King will be dropping down. Arcade goes for Freezing Field, but it's not doing enough damage. The CM will burn. In the meantime, are they doing it? They're ratting, they're trying their very best, as Pablo is in the base as well. Morphling will get himself back in the meantime. He popped the Sven in the backline, so CM died as well. So 3 for 2. They did a little bit more damage to the Metal Racks as well. So looks like No Logic Gaming, they're very worried about defending their base. They do not want to give up that building. In the meantime, Pablo does get seen, does get spotted. He will lose his life as well, as that is a gem given away to the enemy, plus another death on the side of Fort 4 dead. On Horde, now No Logic Gaming will definitely push as they're just pinging down the mid lane. J4 is like mid go now. Alright, let's see if they can make it work. The Morphling is just struggling to take good fights at the moment, and net worth wise, they've lost all of their lead right now. No Logic Gaming, they're officially back in the game, both net worth as well as experience wise. There's still no mega creeps, as that Metalrax in the top lane is standing strong. They have a fortification available very soon as well, so they can keep it alive in the next fight. We'll see. Buybacks on the side of Horde is also running a little bit slim. The Morphling still has cooldown for 4 minutes. And the team is respawning slowly. They will get the TA alive before they have to defend. They have a fortification to buy him those 10 seconds. But the Slaughter will have to use his buyback.
Dire's top tower is under attack.
Alright, let's see. Top lane. Weaver goes in, tries to take the tower very quickly. The Sand King jumps him, gets a bar strike on him. He will be controlled for now. The Morphling goes in with his illusions, with his replicates, with everything available. They need to do the damage. The Shadow Fiend replicate has been taken as well. That can push out the mid lane easily. Plus 50% replicate damage, boys. That is a scary illusion. In the meantime, the logic game, they're still not forcing any more buybacks. The Slaughter has not used it just yet, so looks like it is going to be a successful haul for the side of Horde. They don't want to force anything. They will back themselves up. They will check the Roshan action. Oh, it's up in like 10 seconds. They actually check it a little bit too early. It's going to be up so goddamn soon. And Arke, what's it called? Milani is like scouting it out. He will take away the trap. Oh, but it responds just a second after they leave the pit. How does that happen? Do they actually not check it again? Oh my god, oh my god, oh my god. Ah, guys, that's actually the most unfortunate check of Roche I've ever seen. Like, no logic gaming, they're like, okay, we have to defend the lanes now. Bottom lane is being pushed in, mid lane is being pushed in, but they check it, and 1 second after Roche respawns, they will realize it's up now, but they could have taken it very easily, and now suddenly Horde, they have all 5 heroes back alive, they're out on the map, they are testing, they're checking it themselves, making sure that they're not doing it. They will take away that help as well, make sure that that doesn't do anything fishy. They'll put down some wards, some sentries. Pablo will go in and check in. He will use his ultimate on as well, just making sure they have permanent vision of Roshan. They have a new trap in the pit as well, so Horde, they have a very, very good idea of what's happening. They just wait and see what No Logic Gaming does and try to respond to that. They are on the high ground, they have the vision, so they don't need to, they don't need to force anything. No Logic Gaming, in the meantime, they go into the pit. They try to just burn it down very quickly, and let's see, can they do that? The Morphling can replicate in case of emergency. The Templar illusion will be taken away. They now go back in, and it looks like that is going to be it, as the Morphling is in the bottom lane trying to push in from the bottom area. He does not want to take a fight without having his buyback available, 2 minutes still on cooldown. So they gave up the Aegis. Oh, it was snatched. It was snatched, Pablo. Did it? Whoa. I missed the big thing, boys. He actually just flings in and snatches the Aegis in front of them. Okay, so he's going to have 2 lives available. The Cheese is still in the pit. As they're just moving out, they want to take a fight. The CM in the meantime in the mid lane gets taken down the jump. They get a nice last off, controlling both Arc as well as the Templar Assassin. Templar Assassin dies instantly. Buys back. He wants to take this fight. The Sven will die. The Coon in the meantime is a little bit in trouble. Will burn down. That is, well, the Coon who's not in the game, obviously. Ana respawns with that Aegis now. The Rubik buys back as well. Sand King does have a buyback available as well. The Sven is dead. The CM is dead. They want to keep fighting. They used 2 buybacks already on the side of all. They need to catch more. But what can they catch? What can they catch? Alright, well, again, fortunate that the Coon is still not back in game. I guess his internet is really just like completely dead. So it is indeed a 4v5, let's see. Let's see, they brought back 2 heroes. There's the last available again now, so if everything goes like every single other fight the last like 20 minutes, then the TA will die very quickly, so they need to try and keep him alive. They need to try and make sure he does not get hit by a lasso, but he doesn't really have what it takes. He will be hit by a lasso indeed. He gets control. He may survive this time around. Does have a cheese to be able to keep him alive for a couple of seconds longer. He does try and walk himself away, but again, he just burns and burns and burns with Focus Dota's Bloodthorn. That is a dead TA for 120 seconds. They need to get the Mega Creeps to be able to prolong the game long enough. In the meantime, though, Pablo is running away. He does not want to fight into all of these heroes. Bottom lane, the Morphling is pushing in. He's very low HP. Have another replicate available. Can use his refresh up to get those Manta illusions up and running as well. Looks like that is going to be his play. He just wants to send in a lot of illusions. Or not, I suppose. Or not.
Haste!
That should help.
Alright guys, the Morphling moves out bottom again. Kesa will walk himself away. He's not, well, he doesn't want to fight against his own illusion, but it doesn't really look like he has any issues killing it. And let's see the Morphling. 6,000 gold on him yet again. Still no MKB. Now mid lane is being pushed down. 60 seconds without the Templar Assassin. Looks like no Logic Gaming may be able to force us into a game 3. The Sand King. Oh, he's back. He's back, boys. The Coon. He has returned to the land of the living. So they have all 5 players available. Hold. They're now in the defense. Let's see. The Weaver goes in. They try to force down the tier 4 buildings. They do have fortification available in case of emergency. The Coon. Still alive. Let's see, he tries to set up for something. They get a power strike off onto the Weaver. The Weaver gets controlled. They combo him down. The Weaver dies, has the buyback available, will be able to time dodge himself back in. In the meantime, Gorgsy gets controlled with that lasso. He's not dead yet, though. He does wave from himself away. He does pop up another BKB. Will be live for a couple more moments. Mantis now dodges as well as he survives so closely. Sun comes out on the shadow field, will be controlled for 4 seconds. Mass buyback on hold. They need to defend the Ancient. The Ancient is being mowed down by the Shadow Fiend. The Shadow Fiend needs to be jumped on. They go in and try to get the pop on him. Shadow Fiend dies. That is Morphling. Oh, but the Bloodthorne damage is so huge. The Morphling will die. The Coon will burn down as well. Shadowfiend brought back. Everyone is alive on the side of No Logic Gaming, and they will take the Ancient away from Horde. They cannot defend this. The Coon goes in, tries his very best, tries to do whatever damage he can, but it's too late. It's too little. Excalibur TP's in, but it's already gone. It's gone. Alright, well, that's game 2 goes to the top. No Logic Gaming has to successfully come back. Obviously, being disconnected may have some issues ending the game for Horde on the side of the Coon, but that's what happens, man. You can't wait and wait and wait. That was like, what, 20-30 minute pause or something along those lines. So No Logic Gaming, they'll push it to a game 3. Horde versus No Logic Gaming, game 3 will come up in just a moment. So stay tuned. I hope you enjoyed.